Ladies and gentlemen, out of circumstances that one has no control over, sometimes emerge some of the best ideas and results that you can produce. We had no control over the fact that the president of Brazil is coming to Italy tomorrow. We had some control over the fact that I used all my powers to persuade Paolo Gentiloni to come to Dubrovnik, and he decided, although he has to be back tomorrow, to come for the opening. And then we thought, well, let's now build around this fact something that for all of us in this region, but I think for all of us in Europe and maybe broader, is a key issue. And as we started our opening ceremony by connecting development cooperation to energy and security issues, and we have with us the privilege of Commissioner Canete, who is also going to participate on a different conference, but is here with us, so we want to use this opportunity. We have with us Minister Bushati, with whom Croatia and Italy share the same sea, and through that also many common visions, desires, issues, open questions, problems. And we have with us Amos Hochstein, who, it is true, is the special envoy at the State Department for Energy and Energy Diplomacy, but we all also see him as somehow part of our own region because he understands our region so well. And because he is certainly of a new generation that understands what true cooperation means and what trying to sit down together and solve problems that have, where solutions have consequences for broader, not just one country, but broader regions, and both in terms of security, in terms of energy, and in terms of stability and development of countries in different regions. We, of course, see him as somebody who knows our region of the Adriatic Ionian Basin, or Adriatic Ionian new macro, European macro region, who knows Eastern Europe, who knows Europe in general. So out of these different circumstances, we have built this small pre-panel to discuss security, energy, and development in the Adriatic Basin, in Eastern Europe, in Southeastern Europe, and through that, we believe in Europe and in the world in general. I always said that one of the great advantages of current Italian foreign policy is that for the first time I have a feeling that Italians see Southeastern Europe as not only East, but also South. And through that, we find common grounds for cooperation, but also for responsibility. So I will ask first Paolo Gentiloni, the foreign minister of Italy, to address us on this topic.
Thank you very much, Vesna. Thank colleagues, commissioners, and friends. First of all, I again thanks for the invitation and the opportunity to be here. I also have something to do with Dubrovnik in my youth, but I think many Europeans have shared the same passion And so I was very happy to be here also for this reason. The moment for this year Croatia Forum is a very timely and interesting moment. Not only because of the fact that we are a few days before the Addis Ababa summit, but also because we are in a critical moment for our region, and I mean both for Europe, European Union, the Western Balkans, the Adriatic Sea. We have many challenges. So just a few remarks from my point of view. The first is that talking of the relation between economy and security, we cannot avoid to have a few words about, from my point of view, about Greece. I share the point that was made by Croatian Prime Minister about the fact that we have no easy solution of the Greek issue, and the risk of a Grexit is obviously there. But I think that if we have a political view of the problem and a geopolitical view of the problem, we have to be aware that Europe is obliged to make all possible efforts to solve the issue and to avoid a Grexit. It's not only a matter of percentage, of numbers, of budget, all relevant issues. It's not only an issue of prestige. And I understand that some decisions of the Greek government, especially the decision to call the referendum, created reactions that I perfectly understand. But at the end of the day, I think that we had before in the previous opening session the intervention of the NATO Secretary General, and I think we all know that the Greek issue was one of the most important issues after the Second World War. The destiny of Greece, which side of the story will Greece be placed. And this was a crucial decision in after the Second World War. So we cannot have towards this issue a behavior only based on budget, but we have to consider the necessity of a solution from a political and geopolitical point of view. Second, what is very interesting of this Croatia Forum, Vesna, is the fact that we are having the meeting here in Dubrovnik and in Croatia, exactly as was already said by other interventions, 20 years after the one of the most tremendous events of the war that we had in the Western Balkans 20 years ago, exactly 20 years after Srebrenica. And this means, from my point of view, two things. One is that we can have to learn some, at the end, good lessons from what happened in these 20 years that we have behind us. Good lessons of the consequences of a terrible war and progressive solution to this terrible war. solution based on, at the very beginning, on military intervention, but because NATO had a very relevant role on this. And in a second time, and growingly based on cooperation, economical cooperation, development, and Europe. And this is a way to underline the relation that everybody mentioned in the previous session between development and security. Having development is a condition for security, and obviously vice versa. We are talking in a country and in a region and in a particular time that tells us that this is exactly the case. My third point is that we need a comprehensive approach, talking about development, energy, security, is talking of the necessity of a comprehensive approach in our strategies. And this is fundamental also in the challenge that we are facing from extremism, radicalism, and terrorism. How can we think to defeat terrorism and Daesh if not with a comprehensive approach? We obviously need, and many of our countries are committed in this, we obviously need also to face this threat militarily, but we know that if we are not able to answer to issues that are connected with information, economy, religious dialogue, the youth condition, we will not be able to totally defeat this threat. So the comprehensive approach that we are dealing with, talking today of the mix, energy, development, and security, is also very important from my point of view in struggling and defeating terrorism and Daesh in particular. And finally, let me focus on one specific issue that will be addressed in the also in the Addis Ababa conference, and that is at the center of our discussion also in Europe and in the Mediterranean. And I am referring to the migration issue. Also here, I think we have, looking to our Adriatic Sea, our from Vesna, Ditmir, and me, looking to our, and many others in the room, looking to our Adriatic Sea, we understand that what happened 20 years ago produced also not only a war, atrocities, tragedies, but also an enormous migration and displacement crisis. One of the biggest displacement and migration crises we had within Europe. This crisis was, for my country, very evident, both on the northern part of the country, with people escaping from Croatia, Slovenia, towards Italy, Austria, and other northern countries, as the Croatian Prime Minister remembered in his intervention, and also a enormous crisis through the sea, as Ditmir very well remembers. And maybe many of you also remember the what happened at a certain point. Everybody remembers the image of this stadium in Bari, with dozens of thousands of migrants coming in a few days from Albania through the Adriatic Sea. Well, this is also, in a certain sense, a success story. We still have, obviously, problem of migration in the area, but nothing comparable to the crisis that we had 15 or 20 years ago. What did we do in this 15 years? Well, first, I think we have an experience of peaceful talks, state building, building state capacity in different countries. When the state capacity is there, having agreement, cooperation agreement against traffickers and smugglers. For example, the cooperation we had, Italy and Albania, against traffickers and smugglers that were crossing the sea was very, very effective. And the phenomenon was totally disrupted. In the backstage, and fundamentally, we had economical cooperation and development. So, obviously, we are now facing a migration crisis with different size and characteristic in Africa and in the Middle East. But the spirit and the pillars of the possible solution, from my point of view, are not so different. I personally don't agree with a distinction between strategic measures and emergency and tactical measures. Unfortunately, we need both of them. We need from one side, to reinforce our cooperation, our development initiatives towards the countries of origin of this phenomenon. And for my countries, the countries of origins are mostly Syria, the Horn of Africa, and certain countries of Central Africa. And we have to multiply our efforts as the European Union to cooperation with these countries. And we have to, the second step is we have to try to stabilize the countries that are almost failed countries. It's very difficult to cooperate with failed countries on migration issues. So we have the Syrian crisis, the Libyan crisis, and so on. But at the end, we also have to face the emergency. So what happens in the Mediterranean is not a Greek or Italian problem, it's a European problem. And we have to know this, not pretending, I am saying not pretending from our side, from the Italian side, that Europe solidarity solved the problem, because we perfectly know that geography is there and that we have to afford the main part of the burden being there. But sharing the burden, at least symbolically, is a political challenge for Europe. So I'll close my remarks giving you an example of what I mean. We are discussing since a couple of months, as Vesna very well know, about the relocation of a certain number of migrants having the right of international protection. And the number is, for my country, 24,000 people in 2 years. In the last month of June, we received 27,000 people in 1 month. So we are not expecting to have the solution, and there is no solution. There is a strategy to to manage the problem, as the Western Balkan experience shows us. I'm not expecting a solution. I'm expecting from Europe a common commitment to share responsibility. Because what happens now for the Central Mediterranean or Eastern Mediterranean is also happening from other countries in Europe and could happen also in dramatic measure in the next years for other countries.
Paolo, I will have to
And so we have to, from my point of view, consider the issue as a European issue. Thank you. Thank you, Vesna.
Thank you. Sorry for interrupting you, but I'm really glad you brought up you brought up not only these 4 points of our common interest, but also the fact that this was a place where we had, or this was the region where we had Srebrenica, had war, had atrocities, and through development, through cooperation, it changed. I will now try to sort of go a little faster to Ditmir, because in a way, the energy issue for Albania goes hand in hand with the development issue. And I was thinking, while Paolo was talking, for Albania, what is energy security? Is it to, you know, have a tap, have the pipeline come into Albania and get gas? Or is it diversification? Because if you don't have gas at all, then getting gas is much safer than not having it in the first place. But how do you go in the direction of then increasing security through this?
Thank you, Vesna, and I would like to join Paolo in thanking you for organizing this forum, and it's always a great pleasure to be here, and you are a great host. In the case of Albania, the question is a little bit easier, because it's both. It's ensuring and also diversifying. But I would like also to be focused a little bit on the southern approach, as you were lamenting during your introductory remark, because energy nowadays is part of Europe's most pressing concerns amongst democratization, migration, and security. And since the fall of the communist regime, we have been witnessing a Europe that has overcome the gap that was existing between East and West. So now we see this gap being narrowed. But this is not the case if we compare the gap that is still existing between the northern part and the southern part. And in this respect, energy security has become one of the most important geopolitical parameters of influence in the southern part of Europe. And I speak about the influence of the so-called third actors. And here we speak also about security. But I would also like to bring at your attention the fact that we are living in two worlds. On one hand, we have seen in the past a great deal of virtual pipelines, Nabucco, South Stream, and we have seen governments lobbying for these projects and then renouncing. But so far, the only project that is in the implementing phase is TAP. And the rest of pipelines, like the Turkish Stream, Greeks would like to call it Turkish plus Greek Stream, are only virtual. And this creates also the uncertainty. So now this virtual approach, this virtual world that we have been witnessing so far, is being translated also into an uncertainty. And our hope is that these virtual pipelines are not only geopolitical tools. And in this context, also Iran talks seems not to help, at least so far, to overcome this geopolitical uncertainty. It remains to be seen what kind of equation would be if we are going, or if there is going to be a deal with Iran. And in this context, when we speak about countries of Southeast Europe, we are, I'm afraid, passive actors, because we are lacking instruments, and this is a play largely dominated by US, EU, Russia, and to a certain extent also Turkey. And it's interesting to note also that Russia, for instance, which is one of the main players when it comes to energy, is providing everyday news about new pipelines like Nord Stream capacity, building Turkish stream, Eastern Ring. And one needs to ask also the question, or to pose the question, whether this is really driven by demand-supply arguments, or it's pure geopolitical argument that is behind these plans. And it's a well-known fact, especially for you and Paolo, that are within European Union, that Russia is also playing a little bit also with the EU's weakness when it comes to the unified approach on energy policy, especially in terms of securing external energy supplies. Paolo mentioned also the Greek crisis, and media is a little bit, and public opinion is a little bit poisoned by the economic consequences of the Greek crisis. But there is also a security component of this Greek crisis for our region. There is also a political dimension of this Greek crisis, not only for the European project, but also for the neighbors that are not yet part of European Union, and also for the bilateral issues or disputes that have not been addressed yet. And as we know, with neighbors, you have most of these issues, and these also have it disrupt energy diversification efforts. And I believe this euro crisis has also to be factored in it when it comes to how countries react to gas and pipelines project. And we have seen also the recent statements of the new, not anymore new, Greek government about the Turkish stream, about the implementation of TAP, about the projects that have been negotiated by the previous Greek government. But when we speak about countries, specific countries in our region, and this is my very last comment, I believe we need to engage ourselves, EU and non-EU countries that are part of Southeast Europe, into a more structured dialogue and cooperation, because we feel the need of connecting the energy islands in Southeast Europe. No country can be sufficient itself, and the added value of energy security is also the spillover effect on the economy, on the political cooperation, and on the regional cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Commissioner Canete. I think this is a fantastic point for you to come in. You've heard two foreign ministers, one of a founding member of the EU, one of a candidate country. How do you decide which directions of pipelines should be promoted in Europe? There were different directions that were in vogue for a while and then disappeared, and then some new appeared. How do you see the decision-making around this directions of bringing gas and pipelines into Europe?
And thank you first for your invitation, and second for destroying the paper I have prepared.
I'm terribly sorry.
I'd like to ask you. We Europeans, we live in a very comfortable world in the past, with traditional supply from Russia, from Gazprom as a main player. They decided where were the pipelines, and it was a beautiful world without problems. But suddenly, we discovered with the Ukrainian problems, that energy was used not as a commercial tool, was a political weapon for leverage. And then we realized that we were very vulnerable. And then we made our stress tests. And when we reform our security of gas supply regulation and security of electricity, and we will start thinking how we can be secure as Europeans. And the first thing is building an energy union, building a single energy market for electricity and for gas, not having 28 different markets with different rules and with complicated problems for flow of energy. The second thing is to analyze your level of dependency. If your electricity grid in the Baltic country is synchronized with the Russians, if you have countries who have dependent on a single supplier of gas, they are extremely vulnerable. So all our new strategy is trying that every single country has three different suppliers in the case of gas. And that leads us to put in action an LNG gas strategy, a new way of thinking that there is other alternatives to pipeline gas. So we will develop an LNG strategy in the future, because we have lots of capacity in Croatia. The capacities are building and all over the places.
We are building it already.
But if you have LNG strategy, you need interconnections and you need reverse flows. So we have made lots of progress with reverse flows. And we have, and at the moment when we say we are not interested in building a new big pipeline to connect with Dark Stream, we prefer to develop in the region, in Central and Southern Eastern Europe, many projects of interconnections with reverse flows and make sure that we can, with solidarity, which is an important word not only for immigration, but for security of supply, with solidarity, afford any security energy problem. So we will deal that way. And we will launch high-level dialogues with Norway in the north, with Algeria in the south, to have more supplies. And we also will explore the new possibilities with the United States when we discuss TTIP and the energy chapter there, and how we, in the future, we can have access to those resources that Maro Sekovic, that Minister Moniz have signed all the exporting authorizations. But if you are a partner with a trade agreement, then your condition is more efficient. And there will be lots of gas available in the future. We have to have the networks, the right pipelines, and the most convenient for security of supply. You have lots of pipelines, but a single supplier, you are not in a better position. So that's the way we are going forward. But let me put on the table another risk, because we have a problem with energy, but this generation has a responsibility to tackle the problem of climate change. That's a major problem of security for everybody, a global one. And the most affected will be developing countries for climate change. We also will be touched, we European Union. And climate change is a major task from the security point of view that we have to tackle together. And to tackle climate change, you have to act in the energy sector, because you have to change your energy mix. You have to go for renewables, and you have to go for energy efficiency at the same time. That's a major change in the future. Of course, renewables need backup. Of course, gas will live with us for a very long time. But our energy mix will be changed. We in the European Union will have 27% of renewables at least. We'll have to increase our energy efficiency up to 27-30%. It's a major change. And the most secure way, and the better way to have secure energy is energy efficiency. The energy you don't consume is energy you don't need, don't buy, you don't need more pipelines. So we will act on energy efficiency, we will develop renewables, and we'll have the more intelligent backup with an LNG strategy and the supply routes that are convenient. Southern Corridor is of the utmost importance. That we finish, we develop, we launch it, we connect Azerbaijan with Italy, we can enlarge it in the future, and we can connect in the future with other suppliers, different ones. So that's the way we want to tackle the issue at the moment. Major challenge, energy on one side, but climate change on the other, which has impacts on the energy mix.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This is both very close connections to development. Amos Hochstein, why do you care? Because what we are discussing in terms of energy security is not really Europe. It's Southern Europe, Central Europe, Eastern Europe, because Northern Europe is not really in danger. Nobody is going to cut energy from Northern Europe. But it's this, our part, so to speak, of Europe, that where energy is also closely connected and closely related to an energy security, to development, because all of these countries still have to catch up with the Western and Northern EU neighbors, let's say, or EU co-members. And as the commissioner said, we also now have to deal with alternative sources, taking care of the climate, taking care of all kinds of things that the countries that are considered developed countries today didn't have to deal with while they were growing up, so to speak.
Well, that's a big topic. First, let me say thank you, join everybody else in saying thank you for having me back and for hosting this conference. When I was here in 2013 at this conference, I said two things when I opened. The first was how impressive it was that you put together a conference on such a critical topics and attracting the regional leaders and the global leaders to come. Even though I noted it's very hard to get people to come to Dubrovnik during this time of year. And I have to say that the growth of the importance and the critical nature of the conversation that you've been able to put together at the Croatia Forum has grown exponentially. So congratulations.
Thank you.
And I think it's to the benefit of not only Croatia, but the region that we can have these forums to have these conversations. The second thing I said was that nobody would have thought, we had the opening panel in 2013 was a number of prime ministers and foreign ministers discussing energy security. And that just 2 years earlier, I think it wouldn't have been an anathema to think that energy security would have been dealt with foreign ministers and prime ministers. It was only dealt with energy ministers and those people who think about energy. And that transformation of the understanding of the critical nature that energy plays in the overall policy, foreign policy, security policy, economic policy, development policy, has only strengthened since then. But it was an early recognition, and you know that even before that, the conversation that you had with Secretary Clinton when she came here on her first visit, where so much of the conversation was connecting those dots. And that's where we said at the time that we were at the beginning of a transformation in the world of energy. But I want to amend that, because I think I was wrong when I said that in 2013. We are living in the middle of a revolution. It's already here. We weren't on the cusp of transformation. We are in an era of revolution in energy. And it's whether it's in natural gas and oil and in renewables and looking at the interconnection of energy and policy and foreign policy. You look at the advancement in technology that's occurred over the last 5-10 years compared to the previous 100. People talk in the newspapers every day about how the price of oil has gone. Are we at 57 or are we at 55? And we have articles about the difference between 60 and 54. And is WTI at 51 and oil is at 56? But barely an article about the fact that renewable energy, that solar and wind, have in the same time period have gone down 80% and 70%. And are no longer a conversation that's based on oil and gas, but actually competing with themselves in their own market. So we are in this transformative era. But what happened in the crisis in Ukraine reminded us of the critical nature and interconnection between security and energy. And I say reminded us because it didn't invent the wheel. We've been here before. If you went to the Baltics in the 1990s, soon after the Declaration of Independence, the first action in contrast was cutting off the energy supplies. More than once. In Europe in 2005 and in 2009 and again in 2014, there was a cutoff of energy. Now those who do talk about this, talk about what did the EU do? What is Europe doing? And you know, I think there was a mention before about is Europe only talking and not doing? But I don't think that's fair. I think there's been a a tremendous amount of work done. Not enough, but it takes time. But the third energy package, beginning the process that people saw as a bureaucratic exercise in Europe, had a real national security element of consequence last June. When the supplies into Ukraine were cut off in June, if not for the third energy package and the reverse flow capability, Ukraine would have been facing an enormous crisis in October. They had no gas in reserves. They would not have been able to buy anything during the summer. And they would have reached winter where people would have literally frozen to death. But the third energy package was able to mean that countries in Europe, some in this region, Slovakia and Hungary and later Poland, were able to supply gas and change the dynamic of that crisis. And it just shows you what can be done. So what is the lesson? The lesson is taking it further. And I think Miguel said it right. You don't have to focus on Nabucco and some of the other, you called them, I think, Mr. Minister, virtual pipelines or phantom pipelines, projects that we all talked about for so many years, 10 years or so. But we have real projects. We have a foundation, which is the Southern Corridor, bringing Azerbaijan gas all the way to Italy, through Turkey, Greece, through Georgia, Turkey, Greece, and Albania. But that's just a foundation. What has to happen is right now, Europe is, Eastern and Central Europe, is a number of isolated markets that are not interconnected. And I won't repeat what Miguel said because he's absolutely right. But I want to answer a question that was posed by my friend from Albania saying, I don't know if these projects, Turkish Stream and South Stream and so on, if that's an, I don't know if it's an economic project or if it's a political project. And I want to give a simple formula. If you look at a new project that's being proposed, whether it's those or others inside Europe now being discussed, if they're going to spend multiple billion dollars without achieving economic growth at the end of them, they are a political project. If they are a proposal that will actually create as an investment, that's an economic one. And the difference between Nabucco West and some of the other projects and TAP and the Southern Corridor was that it fit both elements. It was the right thing for Europe from a political perspective, and it made sense, and it was judged and decided on an economic basis. So what we can do here, and I think the window is as smaller than others believe, I think we have a moment in time, an opportunity. And you have countries like Croatia that has to be a critical leader in this process, building the LNG on the Adriatic and interconnecting into Hungary, ultimately into Ukraine, into Serbia, connecting from Greece into Bulgaria from Turkey, supplying gas into Serbia as well, and Romania into Moldova. You think about the transformation of what that could do for the region. And let me just say, when we talk about the connection, the nexus that you talked about, Vesna, earlier, between security and energy and development, it's always been there. You cannot develop an economy, and this is to be the beginning of your question, you cannot develop an economy, any economy, developing or developed, unless you have affordable and reliable access to power, unless you know that you can attract businesses that will tell them that they will have access to that energy. And it doesn't matter if it's in South or Eastern Europe, or if it's in Sub-Saharan Africa, or in Central America, or in Southeast Asia. That is always true. There is no other commodity or sector in the economy that is so directly interlinking of these issues, where they bring that national security element, but without them you can't have economic growth, prosperity, and the basic levels of development. And that's true if you are a small micro business or an extra large business. So I think we have a moment in time here that we can take this opportunity, and I think the EU is well poised to do that with the creation of the concept of energy union, and take it to that next level. You have on the wall here where it says partnership and common vision. And I think on these issues, I've never felt more at home, as you said, in this region, representing the United States and the relationship that we have. And we've, in the creation of the US-EU Energy Council, where we brought together the foreign ministers and the energy ministers from both sides, together with the leadership of the EU, has become an effective mechanism to understand that nexus and try to work together to move it to a brighter future.
Thank you so much, Amos. I can give you each one sentence to end our panel, but I feel very actually excited that we have started our conference on development cooperation by discussing energy. In other words, by discussing really the foundations of self-sufficiency, development, and self-confidence that countries can grow in developing their own energy independence. So, Paolo, you are at the receiving end of TAP. Hopefully, this works out.
Oh, I think TAP is a great project. It will grow during its own development, because I understand also in our Adriatic Ionian macro regions that the connections are growing of the project, and I think it is an example of how we have to connect great pipelines and economical, regional, and political connection. And we have to extend this example also in other areas of Europe, because there are other areas of Europe. I mean, also the traditional Western Europe, where connections are not so easy. I mean, from the gas coming from North Africa. So all the goal of diversification needs now to have within the different region of Europe more connections within our countries, and I think it's possible, and the strategy that Commissioner that the European Commission is making is a good step in advance in this direction. We have good news in some sector, which is good.
Thank you very much. You are the jump off point of TAP across the Adriatic.
And we have been working together, and we have been always having into account the all-inclusive approach of all these strategic important projects. And here, I think it would be important also to consolidate our work on the Ionian Adriatic pipeline that would be connected with Trans-Adriatic pipeline. This would be my first comment, and the second one. Maybe it's time also to think about the extension of this format that US and EU are having together at the level of foreign and energy ministers, also for Southeast Europe and especially for non-EU member states, in order to make sure that we are all on the same board, and at the same time we speak the same language, and we are trying to reduce also the influence of third actors that tend to be quite present also in our region.
Thank you. Commissioner, the third actors.
We in the European Union, we have a clear roadmap in the energy sector. We know how we want to develop an energy union, not only for us, but also for the energy community countries, because it's not an operation only for the 28 member states, although we also have our mind in the energy community countries. But at the same time, we have a responsibility with the rest of the world. In order to make the revolution in energy in the world, in the COP21, we will have to come along with a big financial package of assistance for developing countries, and that mainly will have to tackle with adaptation to climate change, and it will require developing a new energy developments over there. But that will require something very important, that developing countries establish a friendly atmosphere for investment coming from the developed countries. The most important thing is to have clear rules, security, transparency, and then investments will come along and help the development of the energy revolution also in developing countries.
Thank you very much. Amos.
I'll just reiterate, when I say that there's a moment of opportunity, it's because there's an alternative. There are those actors, those third actors that you mentioned, that are coming up with proposals that will cement today's status quo, if they're accepted, will cement them for the next 25 to 30 years. The decisions that will be made in the next year in Europe, the next 9 months to a year, will decide the future. And that sounds like it's hyperbole, but it is actually true. If some of these projects go in a different direction, they will have new 25-year contracts. They will negate all new investment by the private sector as unnecessary. So it's a critical moment. And just the idea of cutting off Ukraine or not cutting off Ukraine, we have to look forward in what is in the best interest of Europe. We have the tools. I think it's already underway. I think it's been decided that it's going to go forward. And I think that's an exciting opportunity because look how it's interlinking from Turkmenistan and Azerbaijan through Turkey to Eastern Mediterranean, from Lebanon to Israel to Egypt, and to North Africa. This is an interconnector that Europe can play not only on energy, but it connects to the previous panel's discussion of all those economic development issues that literally stretch from the Caucasus to the Eastern Mediterranean to North Africa through this region.
Thank you so much. I thank my panel. I would say one conclusion is that energy independence is somehow in the foundations of dignity of any country, the beginning of developing sort of a sense of self. And this is certainly the objective of any development.